Uh-oh. I love this church. We should make fellowship longer, right? Kim's going to tell me, oh, your mic just turned off for some reason. All right. Ah, she did it. Yes. All right, sorry, guys. I'm just not going to be able to do that now. Well, good afternoon, good evening. Glad to see everybody here. I will be explaining part of the reason, if you've wondered why I've been gone for a while. It's actually kind of part of this message and testimony, etc. And you're going to have to give me a little leeway as I kind of wander around a little bit. I promise we'll get there. Those of you who know me well enough, sometimes I do wander a little bit. Thank the Lord that he actually is giving and says, yes, son, come on back over here. Now back over here, right? A little bit of right rein, a little bit of left rein kind of thing. He doesn't whoop me too much. He just pulls the rein a little tighter. Anyhow. Okay, so let us go to the first one. You want to, oh, my clicker's here somewhere. There we go. We got this, I promise. All right. The first verse we have here is 2 Timothy 4, 1 through 5. And I'll explain part of this, and yeah, I promise it'll all go together, at least it should. Is, I solemnly charge you in the presence of God and Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing in his kingdom, preach the word, be ready in season and out of season. That's the main part. There's more to it than that. But this is an example of Christ will give us whatever he needs us to have when we need to have it. It might not seem like it's at the forefront of your mind, but that's what happened. Something happened with Jacob. Tony called me this morning and said, hey, do you have your message ready? I was like, well, kind of. I got like four scriptures. And he's like, well, now, in honesty, though, they sent me stuff like 2+ weeks ago. And I was studying for my final, so I might have missed it. My fault. Sorry about that, Tony. But part of this is understanding that in season or out of season, when you think that you're not ready to share Christ, you're sharing Christ. Did you know that? And sometimes you can actually use words. God's probably wish, son, I wish, Chad, you close your mouth and use a little less words sometimes. So just something to think about there. Dave probably had a good comment for me, didn't you, Dave? So let's go with a part of this is a reprove, rebuke. Oh, I got two words. That's my wife giving me some tension because she's the one that typed this up. It's probably because I deserve it. Exhort with great patience and instruction. I can tell you, I've been guilty lots of times of not being patient in my instruction. I'm learning this even with my kids in the 20-year range. Anybody have that? I believe God gave me them at this age to teach me patience, right? He loves us that much. You're smiling about it. You're thinking about it, aren't you? I can tell. All right. For the time will come when will not endure sound doctrine, but wanting to have their ears tickled, they will accumulate for themselves teachers in accordance to their own desires, and will turn away their ears from the truth and will turn aside to myths. But you, be sober in all things, endure hardship, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. Are we seeing some of that potentially right now? We are, right? We got to stay on the track. God has that track for us. I think sometimes I try to jump off and he's like, I need to get you back on the track there, son. But part of what I'm talking about that's going to be part of this is do the work of an evangelist. Fulfill your ministry. Does that mean you have to stand on the street corner or in the stadiums with thousands and thousands of people? No. It could be that one person you work with. It could be that one person you're at the coffee shop with. That can be you as an evangelist fulfilling your ministry. Anybody believe me on that? Do I got a couple hands? Is there anybody here that feels like they don't have a ministry? This is an extra one. This is extra credit. Just came to mind. I'm like, okay, Lord, I'll say it. Okay, nobody raised a hand. Good. So y'all square. Outstanding. That's what I'm talking about. I love this church. So the next one. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations. baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. There's a reason why all is there, because that is part of my message and my testimony. And all has been such a big deal to me in the last 3 to 4 years. Anybody that all has meant something specific to them or something that has such depth, you're like, what does that even mean, Lord? In that command that I got there, I've heard that we're supposed to do all these things. All truly means all. Woo! Thanks, God. I appreciate that. So, with that, everybody got me on that one so far? I know you're thinking, where is he going with this? I promise you we'll get there. The rest of it says, and he spoke many things to them in parables, saying, behold, the sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seeds fell beside the road, and the birds came and ate them up. Others fell in the rocky places where they did not have much soil, and immediately they sprang up because they had no depth of soil. Okay, we'll break those down just a little bit. The first part is right in the second half of verse 3. What does it say? Behold, the sower went out to sow. What are all of you? Sowers, right? We see right there that the seed went certain places, right? As we're going to go on, it went certain places. So far, does it say that there's anything you're supposed to do besides do what? Sow seed. Cast it out, right? Dave's like, as long as it stays in the grass, I don't have to mow it on the road, but we'll go there with that, right? But are any of those concerns so far, if we talk about verse 5, others fell in the rocky places where they did not have much soil, and immediately they sprang up because they had no depth of soil. Is that anybody here, is that your responsibility? Now, if you might be called to it at a later time, it could be possible that you're there to share more in somebody's faith so they can grow. But that's what we're supposed to do. We're just supposed to cast seed. Don't worry about where it goes, because that's God's responsibility, right? When the sun had risen, they were scorched. Because they had no root, they withered away. Others fell among the thorns, and the thorns came up and choked them out. And others fell on good soil and yielded a crop. Some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. He who has ears, let him hear. Still within that section of verses, does it say anywhere that you as a sower are supposed to do anything else? Above all else, what are you supposed to do? He's asking, he's saying, children, do this. Sow seed. Because ultimately, who works on the spirit in every person? Can we do that? That's the Holy Spirit's job. Let him do it. Put the seed there. Can he do it? Can he do all this without us? The fact is, he wants to with us. That absolutely, I'm not going to apologize for emotion. I'm not. That is his job. Stop worrying about the things that you think you have to do. Do the things that he's told you to do. Whatever, how deep it is, how shallow you think it is, just do that thing. He has given each and every one of you a specific responsibility to do and specific skill sets. And nobody in this room, there's anybody like any one of them. Yeah, we might have some that might look similar to us. They might sound like us. They might look like us. But is there anybody that's exactly the same? God loves each and every one of you individually and has given you individual gifts. Sometimes it feels pretty heavy to carry those gifts, doesn't it? I know it does for me. Now, here's the part, Mark 1:17. And you can look if you feel like it. You can look in some of these verses because I left some of it out, so it wasn't so long. It wasn't that I was trying to cut the context, because those of you that know me, context matters, okay? So there might be more to the story, but just make sure I try not to cut context out because, it's hard. And Jesus said to them, follow me, and I will make you become fishers of men. Did he say, I will make you fishers of men? Depends upon the translation, right? But it says become. So does that mean it happens in an instant? No, it takes time. Thank you, Lord, that you have given me lots of time, because he's like, I've been working on you for a while now, son. But that's what it's going to take time. Don't expect, have the desire to be wherever you think you're supposed to be, but just know if you're not, don't get frustrated. okay? He's going to get you there. All you got to do is keep seeking him. And then I wrote down there, it was my wife's idea. I'll say that. It says testimony. Because part of my message, it might not come across right, but I promise the heart's there. I do. And I'm still confused about it a little, but I'm getting it. Is I've been gone for about 3.5 months. I didn't leave the church. On February 11th, I've been looking to go to a brewing and distilling certification course, Knoxville, Tennessee. Is that the farthest thing from the church is making beer and making spirits? It is, right? Trust me, it is. And so the guy calls me up, said, hey, I know you talked to me a few months ago, because I was just kind of looking. He said, I got a spot for you. I'm like, oh, okay, great. That sounds great. This is the evening of the 11th. He said, it starts the 14th. I said, the 14th, like 3 days, like Valentine's Day. 3 days, Knoxville, Tennessee. He said, yeah. I'm like, I'll call you back. I got to ask my wife. Right? That's not something you're going to be going away for 3+ months and just, hey, honey, see you later. I'm packing my bag. And so ultimately, I went a week later, started, got to do virtual, because why? I was at a chaplain's event in Springfield, and I couldn't skip that because I had all the supplies for the conference. Guys like, yeah, well, you know, we'll work this out. It'll be okay. You aren't going to miss it in the first week. So getting back to that, we think spirits, et cetera, these kind of things, that is the farthest thing from Christ, right? Well, going back to Matthew 28, remember the all I was telling you about? That was the all he just called me to. Why? It's dark. It feels a lot like some of my military experience sometimes, where Jesus' name and God's name is used like every fourth or fifth word because it's part of the culture. Does it make me cringe? Yes, because I finally got away from it, I thought. He's like, no, I need you to go. I'm like, I don't want to go. Anybody done that? So I don't want to go. That looks hard. He said, I told you to go. Yeah, but I want to go. Okay, you're going to provide. Did he test me a little bit and test some of us? Yes, but at the same time, did he increase our faith? Did he provide what we needed? Whew, yes. Was it close? Yes. But that's the faith part, because the thing is, everything you've seen Christ do, what does he do? Did Christ do all the easy things? Did Christ follow the rules? Did Christ follow culture? No, he did everything opposite. Everything. He broke every rule. Why? Because he's like, this doesn't apply to me. I'm God. I'm here to save all of these people, every one of those people. So needless to say, how many times, because we got to do work at distilleries and breweries, free work, free labor. And they're like, well, you don't really participate in all this. I'm like, well, I kind of try to a little bit, but as a whole, I'm like, I don't really need any more of that. Been there, done that. Been a part of that too much. I don't really want it anymore. And then they'd be like, but you work really, really hard and you just do what you're told. I'm like, yeah. Well, why are you like that? Do you really want to know? They open the door, right? What do you got to do sometimes? You might have to do something to get that door open a little bit, right? Buy them a coffee, take them lunch, whatever, sit down, give them your lunch. I don't know. Christ did it, right? He just made things appear out of a piece of bread. Boom, we're feeding 500 plus people. So needless to say, I got to share my testimony with people, and they're like, that's bull blah, right? But they kept coming back. Why is that? Did I sit there with them? Did I sit at a bar with them and maybe have a beer? Did I have water? Did I have soda, seltzer, whatever it was? Yeah. Why? Because sometimes you got to be in the club to have the door open. Does that mean I'm encouraging, hey, go out there and start drinking? That's not what I said. Okay? That's not what I said. So that's part of the testimony, to understand that there might be a place that God's calling you that might look different than what anybody else thinks of or agrees about. But if he tells you to go, what are we supposed to do? Obey. Might not be easy. He never said it was going to be easy, did he? So I will Yes. Let me go back to the notes a little bit because I'm still struggling some of this because some of it's still so real to me. I can't even process it all. And I sure know that it wasn't the way I planned on going. I was happy just staying home. All right. Anybody have any questions on it? I'm willing to talk a little bit, as long as it isn't too much because Kim will turn me off, like I said. Anybody have any questions about it at all? Or not, you can ask me later. Okay. All right. Ephesians 5:15 through 21. Therefore, be careful how you walk, not as unwise men, but as wise. Okay, when you see men, understand that it can't say men and women. Then when it was written, means men and women. And when you see scripture that says brother, or it says sister, it means both unless it's obviously specifically to that gender. Okay? If you haven't read the scripture on that kind of thing, understand that. Sometimes I'm like, why doesn't it say sister? Why doesn't it say woman? He's speaking to both. They just didn't put two sets of words in there. That's all. Making the most of your time because the days are evil. So then, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit. Okay, I'm going to stop right there. That's part of it. Okay, and I wanted to say distill, but that would probably be the wrong word. Is do not get drunk with wine. And different forms of this, it says what? Do not get drunk. Right? If you have a limit and you say, that's it, two beers, that's it. If beer's it, if none's it, that's okay too. Okay, but to understand, God did not say that it wasn't possible. And I've struggled with this because there's been past places that said, we don't touch any of that stuff. Hey, if that's what you do to take care of yourself, to not have addiction or abuse, stick with it. Stand your ground. Okay? I'm not telling you not to, but I'm not telling you to either. But just understand that because God gave us a free will, right? And if God won't violate the free will that he gave me, I have to make sure I don't violate the free will of somebody else because if my God's going to stand on that, well, then I better not do it because I don't have that right. Just something to understand. And I learned that in the past because I said, you can't do that. Really? Why? It doesn't say that. So we can talk about that more further if it gets to it. But be filled with the Spirit. And that doesn't mean alcohol. That means Holy Spirit. Okay? Speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody with your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks for all things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to God, even the Father, and be subject to one another in the fear of Christ. Now, has pretty much most of us seen the fact of somebody that might have been filled with the wrong spirit saying and singing and doing all kinds of crazy things? I have. That might be the time that you as a good brother and sister is like, hey, let me take care of you. Let me do whatever I got to do. Hey, can I give you a ride home? Can I call you an Uber? Right? Because that's what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to take care of our brothers and sisters, whatever it may look like. All right? You feel it. You know it. You're like, hey, I just need to do it. Will they remember? Maybe. But at the same time, your father's probably going to tell you, hey, good job, sis. Good job, daughter. Good job, son. Thanks for taking care of one of my other children. It's possible, right? Things we forget, he doesn't. Oops, whoa, what did I do? Principles of conscience. Okay. Huh, okay. I put that in there for some reason. Let's go with it. He's going to show me. Now accept the one who is weak in faith, but not for the purpose of passing judgment on his opinions. What does that mean? I realized why now. I spent a lot of time with some 20 to 25 folks, and I assure you, we were not in common with the things that we believed. But because there's certain things I stood my ground on, even though I didn't condemn them, I listened, and then I talked to them, what are they going to do? They're going to come back and ask for more. Well, why do you believe that? Because of this. This is how I was raised. How many of us use that one? That's how I was raised, because mom and dad taught me right from wrong. Well, that doesn't mean it's right or wrong. I got the Holy Spirit in me, and he helps me with those things, is to understand it. So that's where I realized that's what that was. We don't want to judge. Yes, there might be a time and a place where we'd be like, hey, that's something wrong. But if you do that right away, what happens? That door that you potentially had open, what does it do? Nothing. It doesn't mean to accept inappropriate behavior or words, but it does mean to love them, but you don't have to accept it. Did I say that right? Everybody got that? Okay. One person has faith that he may eat all things, but he who is weak eats vegetables only. That's odd. Okay. Let's go with the rest of the context. The one who eats is not to regard with contempt the one who does not eat. And the one who does not eat is not to judge the one who eats, for God has accepted him. Thank you, Lord, for accepting me, how you created me, and whatever I've done. Let's see if I got to the right one there. Whoops, I need to go back. Go back, go back, go back. Part of this big story, and I realized I missed a scripture somehow, is all of these things that Jesus did. When we talk about the fisherman and we talk about the zealot and we talk about the tax collector, who can Jesus use to share himself with others? Say it out loud.
Everyone.
One more time. Come on.
Everybody.
Everyone. Everybody. Right? And that is, I thought I could disqualify myself so I don't have to. He's like, no, I've given you responsibility to share me that's in you. I realized, Mr. Tony, I did miss a scripture. And how about, folks, unofficially, if I give you a little bit of homework for next week? Would that be okay? His verse is Acts 2, 36 through 47. And the gist of that, because I'm going to break it down a little bit, is that Christ commands us to do how many things in the church? Fellowship, love, share, all those things that he calls us to do together. And that's what part of that scripture is. It explains all the things that they did back then. Well, Open Range tends to do a lot of those things too, which I think is a really good thing, because it's probably part of the reason why most of us are here, right? Why do we like Open Range? Because of this, because of this, because of this. Because of each one of you and the unique gifts and things that you bring. Now, and part of this I think can be hard. Take it as it is, knowing I'm not trying to throw stones, and if it feels like it, either I'm wrong, you can probably throw it back. Or it might be the Holy Spirit speaking to you, if he isn't speaking to you already. Where is your marketplace? And by marketplace, how I explain this is the last 3 years, I've heard nothing but marketplace, marketplace, marketplace. Anybody else hear that before or wonder what that was? I didn't know. I'm like, Lord, what does this mean? And I kept hearing from people, hey, you're supposed to be an entrepreneur. Well, I've had two businesses. They didn't do so awesome. So maybe there's something else I'm supposed to do, right? Maybe he has another plan. He's like, well, you had to learn from those things to move on and do something else. So where is your marketplace? Your job? Your home? Volunteering? Serving? I'll give an example, and you guys are going to laugh at this. I promise if you don't, you laugh at it. Last week, to realize, and it came to mind because David, I think of David riding it around mowers. Okay, just because when Christ called the disciples, they're walking on their feet, right? Holy Spirit's with them, right? I'm claiming it. David's on the tractor mowing. Now rubber's on the road, but his feet are on the tractor, and what's he doing? Praising and singing, and he's claiming that for Christ, right? I know you do. It wouldn't surprise him if he sings out loud. That's okay, right? That's okay. Nowhere in the scripture does it say we have to sing good. He said with the joyous heart. I carry two buckets because that's what I need in it. Sometimes I borrow some from somebody else too. But I was bottling tequila last week. Tequila, like 456 cases. And as I'm putting cases and putting labels and things away, you think, well, why are you doing that? I'm praying on the tequila. I'm praying on the boxes. Lord, touch the people that these boxes touch, that this palate touches, that these bottles touch, that these things. I know it might sound odd, but to me, that was the conviction he felt for me. When I worked at a jewelry store, I prayed for the pieces I was cleaning. Lord, touch this lady, touch this man. Because why? That spirit flows from us. The Holy Spirit is alive and well in us. It flows out. This is why so many times you see songs that it says flow, right? It flows like a river. Does it flow like a trickle? Well, sometimes in my life, I guarantee the trickle I was probably happy with. But there's times it's been a river. That's what he wants. He wants that spirit to flow out of us. And so I prayed for those boxes. I know it's odd, but I'm like, Lord, just touch them. Can he do it again, once again without us? Absolutely. But is the spirit in us touching those things through them? I believe it's possible. I truly do. I know it might sound odd. So where is your marketplace? And because he called all of you to be what? Fishers of men. Does that mean only men? Nope. Men, women, children, right? Who will you share with this week? If somebody just came to mind, that might be the hardest person you have to notify. Whether it's text, phone, email, whatever. If a name came to mind, found this out about a month ago. A guy was challenged with this, and he's like, I don't even want to talk to that guy because he messed me and my wife over. He sent an email, and the guy basically responded back. I'm trying to remember the details, but the guy's like, why would you even talk to me? He said, because Jesus told me I was supposed to call you. He's like, Jesus, why? And he said, this kind of went back and forth. Finally said, tell me more about this, Jesus. Woo! Right? What if he wouldn't have sent that one email or that text or that phone call? That's fishing, right? You don't always catch. It's not called catching. Cast the seed, right? Same thing. So, follow. What from today's message does Jesus want you to obey this week? Obey. What'd you say? Sow the seed. Yes. It's okay if you guys feel something like you want to say it out. It's okay. All right. Now, I will pray for you guys, but I also have something else when I get done praying. All right, if we'd just go to the Lord in prayer right now. Lord, I just thank you for the opportunities this week that you are going to give to all of us to share you. Lord, that you would fill us with your power and your spirit and wisdom to apply and walk out these things that you're teaching us in your word. Lord, at the same time that you would just give us the grace and the ability to share your love openly in all the ways that you've given us. In your mighty name, amen. And also, I feel like there was something earlier when I got here today, and Tony said, yes, I think that's the case. Is there anybody here that would like prayer? Personal prayer. Because if you would, you could come forward. And Mr. Tony, if you come forward, please. And we will gladly pray for you. I just feel like there's somebody. I can tell you, it was pretty crushing. Kim, could you turn my mic off, please?
I'm getting ready to have some more spine surgery.
Okay. You want to pray for you? What do we do?
I'll start. You finish.
Okay.
Lord Jesus, we just want to lift up Bercy. Lord, you know the needs, you know the desires, you know the things that are on her heart. And Lord, we just expect you to be in each and every area, each and every way. Lord, bless the caregivers, bless the doctors, bless the surgeons, bless everyone around that'll be a part of this. Bless each one in their hands, feet, tongues, whatever it takes to not only perform the procedures, but help her feel confident in the result. Yes. Lord, let her be victorious over this. Let this change her life. Let the pain go away, Lord. Bring it out, bring it forward, and let her become fully yours, we pray.
Lord, I thank you for this sister. Lord, she stepped out in faith in front of others, Lord, just like they did, like the woman that touched your garment, Lord. She would touch her, Lord, from the top of her head to the soles of her feet. Lord, you would touch her spine, straighten it, anything that's going on, Lord. I don't know why five matters. But Lord, you just touch that, and you just touch all things and anything that's coming, Lord, because you created her perfectly, Lord. And that you would just put her body back to where you created her, Lord. Mm-hmm. In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
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 Thank you.
Would there be anybody else?
Okay. All righty. Thank you, everybody, for giving me a lot of grace. Like I said, sometimes I wonder, and hopefully there's something that touched your heart, and if there's something that you didn't like or didn't like, please tell me personally, okay? Because part of one of the scriptures earlier said what? We're supposed to help each other. We are supposed to, hey, you know, you kind of did that. That should be my heart. What could my heart be? No! Right? Well, then I probably deserve a rebuke, and you better get two or three people. But generally, that's what our heart should be, because why? We're all in different places in our faith and our knowledge and experience, and God's given you something to share with others, because why? That's what the family is. That's what the whole body is for, is to help each other in certain ways. And don't believe that lie that you think you can't help somebody else, that you can't be that person that Christ put there for them. Don't believe it. Do not believe that lie. All righty. So do I need to close in prayer? All right. Lord, I just thank you for this body, Lord. Brothers and sisters getting here together, Lord, and that you just keep them safe in this weekend and all the people they know also, Lord, with this weekend. I thank you for your heart that you've put in others to serve, Lord, in whatever way they do. And you would just touch all the families, Lord, even now. And just pray your spirit would go out with them this week, Lord, and that you would just pour through them like a rushing river to others. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Often said that, you know, it's the least I can do when you're